Welcome back from your virtual break. I trust that you took full advantage not only to rejuvenate but also to exchange amongst peers and colleagues participating in this policy lab. We'll now turn to the second plenary on transforming the multilateral framework for peace. This will be facilitated and led by Ms. Susana Malcorra, current Dean of the IE School of Global and Public Affairs, who brings a distinguished career having served her country, Argentina, as foreign minister, as well as in numerous positions at a senior level with international organizations, not least of which as an Undersecretary General of the United Nations, as well as Chief of Staff of the UN Secretary General. Susana, I give you the floor, Ms. Malcorra, to introduce the distinguished panel.
Thank you very much. It is a pleasure to be with you. And let me start by thanking the World Leadership Alliance and Club de Madrid for asking me to facilitate this conversation. I will say it's going to be a very easy job because the speakers that will join me in this conversation, in this live conversation, are experts in different areas that we're going to discuss. But more important, they are people who care about the multilateral system, and I'm sure they will be passionate describing ways to transform this multilateral framework for peace that we are trying to address here. As we all know, in the 75th General Assembly, commemorating the 75th anniversary of the policy, the Secretary General has been tasked to develop ideas to reinvigorate the multilateral cooperation in 12 different areas, and one of them is precisely peace and security, in which we are going to be discussing now. So in this regard, we will have a vivid conversation, a lively conversation, but most importantly, I have no doubt, my colleagues and friends will introduce views on this notion of inclusiveness, networking, and coordinating multilateralism in a very, very creative manner. So without delaying, let me start by introducing people who are going to be joining this live conversation. First of all, President Chinchilla, Ms. Laura Chinchilla, President of Costa Rica, and Vice President of the World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid. Welcome, Laura, my good friend. Then Ms. Melanne Verveer, Executive Director of Georgetown Institute for Women, Peace and Security. She will, of course, give us the gender angle. Mr. Kai Brand Jacobsen, President, Romanian Peace Institute, Director of the Department of Peace Operations, welcome. Then Mr. Terje Roth Larsen, another good friend, welcome, Terje. He is the President of the International Peace Institute in New York. And finally, last but not least, Ms. Amina Touré, Prime Minister of Senegal between 2013 and 2014, and member of the World Leadership Alliance Club de Madrid. So going straight into our conversation, I will now pass this virtual floor to President Chinchilla. President Chinchilla, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Susana. It is a pleasure for me to be part of this session with such distinguished panelists. Before sharing my views, I want to apologize for not being able to stay after the presentations of the other four speakers. But let me start by acknowledging the relevance of the multilateral system and the United Nations itself in sustainable and noteworthy peacekeeping efforts over the years. For decades, the world experienced progress and stability like probably never before, at least since the dawn of the 20th century. The expansion of international trade and democracy were as instrumental in this regard as the multiplication of international organizations. globalization was largely a positive force, and although not in the absence of regional and national conflicts, the world didn't see a major power conflict erupting in more than six decades. It was the longest period in modern history of prolonged peace among great powers. The average war so far in the 21st century kills 90% fewer people than almost every major conflict in 1950s. This is quite an achievement for many peaceful forces, most of them related to the multilateral system. However, today we are facing several non-conventional threats. One of them, the COVID-19 pandemic, has brought not only death in a global scale, but a multidimensional crisis affecting people's health, severely harming the economy, and triggering profound transforming implications in both the societal and political fields. The COVID-19 outbreak occurred in a context of other serious problems challenging transnational governance, such as the migration and refugee crisis, the devastating impacts of climate change, resource depletion, and rising inequality and polarization. Further, we were already experiencing an alarming process in which the world seems to be fragmenting by the return of nativism, autarky, protectionism, illiberal democracies, treaty withdrawals, and a worrisome emphasis on military and economic coercion from some great powers, jeopardizing multilateralism and global governance. The ongoing pandemic is both, at the same time, a defining moment that may considerably weaken the legacy of 25 years of nations working together to solve problems, and an opportunity to make those same institutions and frameworks fully effective. In this context, I would like to make a few comments on how to contribute to strengthening and increasing the effectiveness of the multilateral system to promote and sustain peace and stability. My comments underline the importance of top-down and bottom-up approach. First, we must think beyond the box and consider how to repurpose our global institutions towards new ends. In doing so, it is necessary to build more inclusive and dynamic multi-stakeholder approaches, allowing the participation of new actors such as civil society organizations, private business, and subnational entities, among others. The idea is to prompt the configuration of a new movement in favor of multilateralism and global cooperation, not necessarily upon the traditional lines and frameworks. In this regard, we might get inspiration from recent experiences, such as the initiatives against global warming, mostly heralded by young people, and those on gender equality led by women in many countries around the world. Secondly, we must critically review our international organizations and push for ambitious reform that can lead to more democratic structures, to heighten its effectiveness, and to enhance its capacity to meet current challenges. In that sense, it is necessary to design more effective strategies to translate guiding principles such as social justice, inclusion, and equity into reality. There won't be sustainable peace and security if we are not able to answer effectively to the serious inequality and social exclusion problems which are getting worse with the COVID-19 crisis. In the case of the global economic governance institutions, this means going beyond building better capacities for understanding and for understanding and impacting goals of social cohesion and equity to making them mission level objectives of their economic philosophy. The challenge is, therefore, to ensure that our global economic institutions become standard bearers for broad-based economic well-being, inclusion, and equity. To finalize my intervention, I would like to say some words on political leadership. Those are times when we can be neutral about political leadership, and what we can also learn from the role that female leaders are playing during these times of crisis. I know that Melanne will talk about the role of women in peace building in greater depth. Mine is just a reflection on the way they are leading. Although institutions are important and we must spare no efforts in strengthening them with high standards of efficiency, transparency, and inclusion, political leadership is critical when tracing paths and promoting change. In defining times such as the current times, political leadership becomes even more relevant. Despite the fact that just few governments are headed by women, the data show that some 40% of the cases of reasonable successful management of the pandemic have been led by women. The data is actually most illuminating. As of late September 2020, coronavirus deaths per 100,000 people have been 11.4 in Germany, 6.2 in Finland, 5.0 in Norway, 2.9 in Iceland, 0.5 in New Zealand, and 0.03 in Taiwan, compared to 68.7 in Brazil, 63.4 in the United States, 62.4 in UK, and 60.12 in Mexico. It is true that those female leaders who represent nations with strong institutions, solid democracies, and high standards of human development, those factors seem to facilitate a responsible pandemic management. However, not all democracies with the same levels of human development have managed well the pandemic. I am convinced that in these cases, the difference has largely relied on the quality of female leadership. Beyond their individual strengths and merits, among women, that are particularly relevant in conditions like those we are experiencing with the pandemic disease. The first is respect and thoughtfulness. Women tend to display a distinctive approach to power. It is a less arrogant attitude, much more willing to listen and conform policy with respect and discipline to technical and scientific criteria. This is a moment where politicians have been forced to abide, like probably never before, to science and experts. And this should continue being the case if we want to successfully tackle other global challenges such as global warming and technological disruption. Second, empathy. Women have an increased ability to identify with other people's feelings and needs. This is a moment where the conditions of leadership, such as compassion and solidarity, are being put to test. And finally, women's collaborative leadership style is well suited to coalition building and dialogue, much necessary conditions in moments in which leaders need to bridge social divides, build political cohesion and consensus, as opposed to polarizing and divisive approaches to governing. So to summarize, in order to advance the transformation we envision for a fair and inclusive global order that is based on trust and mutual respect among nations, we need to promote changes at all levels. In society, mobilizing multiple forces that can create positive synergies in the structure and functioning of the international institutions and in the quality of leadership, which goes along with empowering women and giving them the opportunity to lead. Thank you.
Thank you, President Chinchilla. You have good initial inspiration, not only talking about the issues at large, but focusing on leadership. And you have provided an angle in leadership that is a perfect beginning and introduction to the next speaker, who is going to be Ambassador Melanne Verveer. Ambassador Verveer handles and cares about these issues and works on these issues and has worked with these issues for a long time. So I have no doubt she will be able to deepen in your issue. So, Melanne, over to you. We don't hear you, Melanne. At the bottom, there is a bar, and there you will see the mic. Why don't we do the following? Why don't I move to our next speaker, and then I come back to Melanne while we sort out this little technical problem. So then I will go to Kai Brand Jacobson to talk about another angle in this view on the question of the framework for peace, and that is the angle of bringing other stakeholders into it and seeing how those stakeholders can play a role in being in developing a stronger framework for peace. So Kai, over to you.
Thank you very much. It is an honor and a pleasure to be here today with such a distinguished gathering of speakers and also our audience joining us from around the world. For many years, peacebuilding was seen as the work of governments and senior political figures, military and armed actors. It was one of the early pioneers of peacebuilding pointed out many, many years ago, peace is too important to leave in the hands of heads of states and military. From the 90s onwards, we saw a dramatic increase in the role of NGOs engaging and working with conflict and prevention of armed violence around the world. And through the 2000s, particularly from 2001 onward, we've seen a dramatic increase in the engagement of companies and private corporate actors working across a wide range of activities related to the development, humanitarian, and peace nexus. With all of these evolutions, we're seeing a widening of the actors engaging in peace, and in particular, the powerful rise and emergence, as has already been spoken to today, of women's efforts and work for peace building in many conflict contexts around the world and globally, and the increasing engagement of youth. In this context, there is a need and a tremendous potential to see how we can engage actors at every level of society, and how different spheres of our social life and global systems can themselves become positive peace supporting rather than violence enhancing or themselves systems of violence. I very much appreciate Alexander Stubbs' question. How can we muster a quorum of nation states and citizens to transform our current global system? I think we need to be more innovative, more visionary, and more realistic in our work to answer that question. A multilateral framework and multilateral cooperation are important. In many ways, on many issues, they're essential. From our global crisis of climate destruction and species extinction, vastly unequal and exploitative economic systems, in which we have greater and greater concentration of wealth in a narrow, undemocratic minority, while many hundreds of millions, if not billions, work in extremely poor, insecure, and frequently perilous conditions, also including the challenges of massive tax avoidance in which trillions of dollars are not paid in tax by companies and wealthy elites, affecting our capability within our countries to invest in infrastructure and the necessary education and health architecture, which has been mentioned as being so vitally important and that we're seeing stressed in this time of COVID. This new world disorder, this moment of tremendous transformation and change, was evident well before COVID. The reality is we've been in multiple crises for some time. When you look at these crises, it's important that we also try to understand the nature. They're dynamic, they're complex, they're multi-causal, they're often self-reinforcing, and they're beyond the capability of any one single sector or actor to address. As Alexander Stubbegain said, we need new ways of addressing this. While a UN 2.0, I think, is a vital and critically important element of this, while a rules-based multilateral system is important, they're not enough. And when it comes to stopping conflicts and addressing violence on the ground, they're also not always necessarily the most important or critical factor. New models of governance and collaboration are essential, but we also need the architecture and the infrastructure and the training for it. The number of people working in the field of peacebuilding, prevention, and post-war stabilization recovery has grown. There are, in reality, far too few people who are really properly trained and know how to actually do it. Whether we're speaking about mediators or foreign office personnel and diplomats, to local government officials, police officers, and civil society practitioners on the ground. We also need to move beyond what is still our dominant external intervention-based approach, dependent upon external agencies and NGOs, and focus much more on strengthening effective local infrastructure and capabilities. Our current approaches are still very much intervention-based. You can look at the fact that it's estimated that over 90% of funding for peacebuilding and prevention goes to foreign NGOs. A lot of that then goes to local actors, but the ones making the decisions, deciding on the projects, and the tremendous amount of resources going for overhead and offices in the north is then not there to support building the capabilities in the south. Imagine apply this model to other sectors. Imagine if I were a heart attack or my children were sick and I needed to wait for a foreign agency or NGO to come set up a health clinic, which in reality is unfortunately the case in many contexts. But that's not what we want. We want a quality health system from local community levels to national training of health workers, pharmacies, community-based healthcare, national health ministries. If the building I'm in right now is on fire and burning, I don't want to wait for decisions by foreign heads of states or foreign agencies. I want a good fire management and prevention system, firefighters trained, proper investment at a local level. And the same for education. If I need my children to go to school, I don't want it to depend upon the whim of foreign funding or a charity or an NGO to decide they want to come set up a school. I want a good quality education system, which everyone has access to, regardless of gender, whether they live in rural or urban areas, what economic bracket they come from. The same should be true for peace. If we want to address the crises and issues we're speaking about, we need robust capabilities and infrastructure for peace at every single level, from within our communities at local to national levels, from local peace committees to training local government officials and services to reforming how we do policing so that it can become peace enhancing, to looking at our economic budgets. We speak about peace and conflict impact assessments for individual projects, but rarely when we look at local and national budgeting. And imagine if we looked at this with regards to education. We have health education in our schools in many countries in the world because we recognize for the well-being of individuals and community, we all need to understand basic hygiene. Again, during times of pandemic and health crises like Ebola or COVID-19, we see the dramatic importance of this. It doesn't mean we're all going to become nurses and doctors, but we need to have good health education. The same for math. We may not all become Albert Einstein or do advanced mathematics, but for well-being in our daily life, we know that we need maths. The same is true for people. Every one of us has conflicts. It doesn't matter where we're from in the world or our backgrounds or beliefs and identity. Imagine if we had peace education at every level in our schools. What's interesting is when you look at the World Economic Forum's mapping of the competencies we need for the 21st century, they speak about critical and constructive thinking, collaboration, which has been mentioned, the importance of collaborative leadership, creativity, problem solving, adaptability, being able to have constructive interactions with others who may have different views than our own. But in most of our schools in the world today, we don't learn the skill set for that. That's what peace education is about. I've been asking in particular about the role of business and peace, conflict sensitivity, and the potential for business as an actor for peace. And this speaks to the hearts of my comments before. I also want to recognize the superb work of pioneers in the field like Jason Nicklian, Pierre Schouten, Cindy Hurst, and Øystein Rolandsen, and in particular, if it's of interest for people, the Business and Peacebuilding, 7 Ways to Maximize Positive Impact. But I want to start first by looking at war. War has a devastating impact on business and economics. All we need to get Syria, Libya, and Afghanistan, its impact on the U.S. economy, Iraq, and many other countries to see the devastating impact of war. The tens of thousands to cumulatively millions killed by both direct and indirect impacts and effects of violence and war. Health systems devastated, millions driven from their homes, destabilization of regions, the visible and invisible impacts on people's lives and society, massive brain drain, destruction of education, lack of investment, destruction of infrastructure, and more. For years, we were told that war happens because of the greed of business and industry, and it's good for business. But in reality, the reverse is true. War is good for weapons industry. It's good for the black market. It's good for smuggling. But it devastates most economic areas of our economy. If you look at much of business today, in particular sectors like the tech industry, a lot of what business looks for is optimization. What works? How do we overcome and improve illogical or dysfunctional systems? This is an area where we can engage business and people at the frontiers of many fields to explore and look together for ways of solving and addressing conflicts and the systemic issues and challenges we face in our world today. Also domestically within countries affected by instability and war, the overwhelming majority of businesses who are negatively affected could become potential actors and drivers. Some practical things that we could be focusing on. Working together with the United Nations and the Institute for Economics and Peace to carry out robust analysis within countries of the economic conditions and drivers which might contribute to conflict, and looking at developing together with business, labor, and others within countries, upstream measures for what can be done to address and to strengthen prevention. As I mentioned before, we should do peace and conflict impact assessments of local and national budgets. And a critical recommendation is to have nations assuming responsibility for the peace impact of their entire operational presence, assuring that the whole chain of suppliers and subcontractors is conflict-free. In a global economy, which has a very complex supply and distribution chains, due diligence of supply chains is key to a commitment to strengthening more peaceful societies. We see the same when it comes to women's rights, to human rights broadly, to impact on environment. So this is not a unique issue that needs to be addressed. It's something where we can couple and partner together with others. And measures like those recommended by Danilo Turk on a macroeconomic level, the need for debt suspension and erasure of illegitimate debts. Multinational corporations and their supply chains reach deep into each of our societies and to conflict and fragile communities around the world. This is one of the reasons why Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, who will also be speaking these days, and colleagues at the UN pioneered in 2013 the Business for Peace Initiative to try and look at how businesses can take a proactive role in supporting peace. Today, more than $8 trillion in investment is benchmarked towards the SDGs, and 20,000 signatory companies are signatories to varied peace and development initiatives around the world. But the challenge is that the aspirational elements of business engagement in peacebuilding are not yet matched by the realities on the ground. For many companies, including those which are signatories to these agreements, their actual practices in conflict-affected communities are still often conflict-enhancing and escalating of violence. And whereas when you look at the firm level of an individual company and assess its impact on peace and development, it might look positive, when you look at the broader overall cumulative spillover effects of their business in conflict-affected communities, it's often quite negative. A conflict-sensitive approach is based upon the need for robust analysis and understanding of the conflict drivers and dynamics and how businesses can impact upon it. But we need to go beyond looking at the responsibility and role of individual businesses to making sure that we have strong and robust regulation and independent oversight. We face challenges, for example, in Somaliland, DP World acquired the Berber Port concession, a major area employing many people, and this led to instability and risked enhancing conflict and destabilizing peace. In Myanmar and Eastern Congo, you have external companies who have engaged in local business practices, often funneling resources to local warlords and actors. I know I only have a little bit of time left, so I want to speak to the essence. War is a failed and bankrupt system, and yet we still invest trillions every year in military, training of military, and the arms industry worldwide. If we want to truly address the multiple crises and challenges we face, we need to become better at dealing with conflicts effectively and finding real and robust solutions. Today, a lot of our work is ad hoc. It's done by wonderful NGOs and agencies we can praise, but there's not enough whole of society collaboration and working together to build upon our capabilities to find real and effective solutions to transform conflicts effectively, to prevent violence, and to build sustainable peace.
Thank you, Kai. You have left us with a broad range of to-dos and shown us the complexity of the network that needs to be established, including a private sector as a central player. Let me now give the floor to Prime Minister Amina Touré. Prime Minister Touré brings a breadth of experience, and not the least as playing that critical role in her country, but also a very relevant experience from justice and a very relevant experience in the multilateral system. So, Prime Minister Touré, will you give us your view in this regard?
Thank you very much. I had a text, but I think I'm gonna put it aside. And so I'll give you my more, I would say, direct. So my apologies for not being that diplomatic.
From the heart.
Remember the title of our discussion, Transforming the Multilateral Framework for Peace, Mechanism to Contribute to an Inclusive, Networked and Coordinated Multilateralism Conducive to Sustain Peace. So I would like to maybe start from where we are, which is hopefully the end of this pandemic of COVID, as an example and a starting point to what I would like to say. I think we really need to work hard to restore the hope that the people have in multilateralism, at least from my standpoint here in Africa and Senegal. When the pandemic started, we heard a lot of discourse. By the way, we are still waiting for apologies for not having died for millions, which is also showing that we are still carrying some stereotypes, even within the multilateral community, because when it's about Africa, we expect that we would fail, which didn't happen. So from where I am, we are sort of for us who strongly believe in multilateralism, we have to find strong argument in the face of what happened in the beginning of COVID. Most of the agencies, experts, had to leave back home, and we were left with our own national resources to deal with COVID. And from Senegal, we are happy to say that we have been quoted as the second country worldwide put forward good policies, which means that my first point, if you want to sustain peace at the international level through multilateralism mechanism, we have to make sure that they support national mechanism. So that's a very a point that I strongly believe in. Having worked through it, I knew that before, but COVID was the recent example. If we do want to be relevant at country level, because we are doing multilateralism to serve the people at the country level. So if we appear as something far away from the people, we won't be able to have any sort of impact related to peace at country level, where most of the conflicts happen within countries or neighboring countries. So that's my first point. How are we going to build a mechanism that reinforce capacity of states to face peace issues. That is very important. So, which means that multilateralism needs to be a little bit more inclusive, be it by identifying very critical groups at country level, of course, starting by government, but identifying very important groups like women's groups, youth groups, religious groups, and being able as a multilateral body, be it the UN or any other sort of international body, to strengthen actors at country level. That's one. Second, we have to restore the international human rights agenda within international cooperation, international multilateralism, because we have to acknowledge that for the past 4 years, multilateralism has been under attack. So those are issues that we have to say, being through attack of the international human rights agenda, being not respecting a financial commitment, and even removing financial resources from an international body that plays a critical role, WHO. So these are the issues today that we have also to say very openly. And I think if we really would like the people we are supposed to be serving from the international level, through international cooperation, through the UN, that are the issues we have to bring to the core. Second is the commitment of the international community through multilateralism. There is a lot to say about committing 1% of the resources for international cooperation. Many countries are lagging behind, and it's important to remind them that if we really would like to have the support of, I would say, developing or emerging countries, it's important that people keep their words and keep their promises. If we don't do that, what we have is that we do have young people. Let me remind our friends that 70% of the African population is below 35. So when you talk about Africa, you're talking about young people. And we do know that young people are more principle-oriented, and it's important that they believe that all these mechanisms are relevant to their life, which we have to still demonstrate in many situations. And as I said, during the COVID time, I'm not sure we demonstrated that. So we have to catch up. The best way to catch up, we do have a topic in front of us. It is going to be access to vaccine. Let me tell you, for access to tests, international cooperation is not delivering enough. I can say that. But at least for the next step, which is access to vaccine, let's hope that we will be able to bring the international community, meaning countries from the north and the south, through the mechanism they have together put in place, the biggest one being the UN, but we do have other multilateralism mechanism, that they would address this very critical issue of access to vaccine as a human right. So that one, at least, would sort of let us forget that in the first phase of COVID, the promise of multilateralism didn't play out. I think we have a lot to catch up about. The third thing is, how are we going to be able to convene a discussion between the states, the representative of the people within the states, and the business community? It's important because it appears from some part of the world, my part of the world, Africa, that you do have international business overriding any other body at the international level. That's a feeling, and I think somehow it's a reality too. So we do have to foster also this dialogue with the international community to make sure that they abide to the international agenda, that they respect the environment, that they respect the rights of the people, that they respect the principle of decent jobs, etc. So I do think that after COVID, we do have an opportunity maybe to reassess the international agenda, which I must say have been weakened throughout this 6 to 8 months of COVID. We witnessed a regression in terms of cooperation. Borders were closed. Money stopped flowing in some development programs, etc. But the good thing is, many countries had to rely here in Africa, from my own experience here in Senegal, had to rely on their own resources. So they discover expertise that they don't even think they had, so which have built a new self-confident. And multilateralism should not see it as, okay, we retrieve from it. But as I said in the beginning, if you have to make multilateralism relevant, it has to support the countries to be self-sufficient, to develop their own expertise, to deal with their own issues, and to benefit from international knowledge. And that's the way, you know, the young people we are serving mostly in my part of the world, as I said, 70% of the population of Africa is below 35. So they are the one who will build the peace or who will destroy it. And abiding by the principle we all set for ourselves as an international community is very important to build trust and confidence with this 70% of the African population. So let me stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Prime Minister. You gave us a strong reminder of the energy and the strength of Africa, particularly represented by its young people. And that is exactly the case. So it was really good to hear you off the cuff, not reading your paper, and hearing you from the heart. I think that is central to having this live conversation. Let me now go to my good friend, Terje Roth Larsen. Terje, I know that you will bring a different angle to this conversation now, talking about how to widen the network, how to make it stronger to work on peace and conflict resolution. So, Terje, over to you.
Thank you very much, Susanna, for those words, and it's good to see you again, and it's good to hear you again. Excellencies, colleagues, and dear friends, good morning, or good afternoon, or good evening to all of you in the various time zones we are all in. I'm very glad to be with you today to discuss issues that are important to me and reflect the work of the International Peace Institute, IPI, an organization which actually this year is celebrating its 50th anniversary. The UN's vision of sustaining peace puts conflict prevention and peace building at the very heart of the organization's work around the world. The vision emphasizes that peace and sustainable development are interrelated, and that national and local actors must lead in prevention and peace building efforts, with UN and other international players playing supportive roles. And I think this is very important, and I think that reflects several of the other remarks made here, that the national and local actors must lead, and the international organizations must support. While UN member states endorsed this vision back in 2016, as you remember very well, Susanna, it has faced an increasingly challenging global context to put sustaining peace into practice. Poor governance, exclusion, and socioeconomic inequalities continue to drive instability in many, many countries. Civilians around the world remain vulnerable to violent threats from their own governments and armed groups. Climate degradation, migration, extremism, and the coronavirus pandemic demonstrates how quickly developments in one part of the world can impact peace and stability in other areas. These dynamics have particularly tested the UN Security Council's abilities to deliver on its mandate over international peace and security. Growing competition amongst its most powerful members hamper the body's abilities to deliver coherent political solutions. The Council's traditional tools of peacekeeping operations, political missions, and good offices and good office diplomacy have also struggled to effectively achieve their goals in light of unified political support from its member states. All of these developments points to a reality where no single organization can prevent conflicts and build peace on their own. And this is why, over the past decade in particular, the UN and the Security Council have given priority to closer cooperation with regional actors and organizations. Partnerships between the UN and regional organizations are necessary to improve the political legitimacy and effectiveness of collective peace and security cooperation. Cooperation depends on common goals, on shared analysis of the situation at hand, and a coherent approach to joint political engagement. It also asks the member states to build a common understanding of each organization's comparative strengths and limitations in any given situation. The UN's partnership with the African Union is emblematic of this push for closer regional cooperation, an issue that IPI has followed closely over the past 2 years. Since 2002, the cooperation has evolved from a narrow focus on peacekeeping to a comprehensive partnership across the peace and security spectrum. This cooperation happens not only at the institutional level, but also amongst the organization's member states. Just last week, the members of the UN Security Council and the African Union Peace and Security Council met for the 14th consecutive year to discuss critical situations, in particularly in Mali and in Somalia. While the UN-African Union partnership is particularly strong, it is not the only regional organization that is striving to forge a closer relationship with the UN in conflict prevention and peace building. The European Union has a long-standing partnership with the UN, including in support of the organization's peacekeeping missions and peacebuilding initiatives around the world. Recent political initiatives by the UN Security Council have sought to raise attention for the growing importance of stronger partnership between the UN, the League of Arab States, ASEAN, La Francophonie, and other regional organizations. But while more predictable cooperation between organizations is an important part of the puzzle, it is not the only part of the puzzle. Effective multilateral cooperation also depends to the extent to which the regions themselves are able to foster closer coordination and integration. And this is where I think we need to devote more collective effort to improve multilateral conflict prevention and peace building. On one end of the spectrum, Africa's peace and security architecture rests upon the efforts of the continent's sub-regional organizations. They are often the first to respond to crises and have the contextual knowledge and the legitimacy to engage. Many of these sub-regional organizations have prioritized peace building, coordination, and development integration. It is on these issues where I see challenges and opportunities for the MENA region. As we all know, the Middle East and North Africa region is again at a critical historical juncture. As I see it, the region is facing three deep running major challenges. One, unprecedented demographic changes. Two, rapidly increasing complexity of conflict patterns. And three, a region where less coordination and integration than in any other region of the world. Regarding the first point, demographics, let me give you a few statistics that outline the future trend. The population in the Arab world is estimated to increase by at least 100 million by year 2030. By 2050, the population in Egypt will be more than the double of what it was in the year 2000. And while in 1950, Europe had twice the population of Africa, soon it will be the opposite. Actually, by 2050, the population of Africa is projected to be three times the size of Europe's. A number of states in the region will face an uphill battle to provide jobs, education, and social services to their growing populations. For Europe, these demographic developments on its borders will potentially make migration issues of today minuscule compared to what they will become tomorrow. The MENA region has also never been as conflicted as it is today. Currently, there are ongoing conflicts, as we all know, predominantly in Iraq, Libya, Syria, Yemen, and Israel-Palestine. As we all know, there are also simmering tensions between a number of additional states or entities in the region that could actually explode at any moment. These difficulties are underlined and exacerbated by the fact that the Middle East and North Africa, the region, is the least integrated and organized region in the world. As a result, there is no forum similar to the European Union, the Council of Europe, ASEAN, African Union, and so on and so forth, in which to address these and other issues of vital importance. While the existing regional organizations play an important role, there is no institution that includes all the states of the region. As a result, the MENA region often embraces the policy of the empty chair. There is no table where you have all the Arab states, Israel, Turkey, and Iran. The seats are empty. I have for many years now advocated for creating a space for dialogue that includes all parties. And I think there have been some positive developments here recently in this regard, where two more countries, the UAE and Bahrain, have established diplomatic ties with Israel. And it is my strong belief that this can only strengthen the Arab voice in the Arab-Israeli conflict by having a presence at the table. Thank you very much, Susanna.
Thank you, Terje. It's always very, very interesting to hear your insights, given the knowledge you have from these regions. So a lot of food for thought, a lot of data that provides us with elements to assess the challenges ahead of us. Now I will go back to my good friend Melanne, and I hope that technology will allow us to connect. Melanne, over to you.
Well, I hope the technology is working, is it?
Perfectly.
Excellent. It still defies credulity as to why there was a problem. However, thank you very much, Susanna, and to my fellow panelists. An enormous debt of gratitude for the dimensions that you focused on in demonstrating just how complex these issues are that surround sustaining peace, but also the great possibilities if we embrace all of the factors that are critical to solutions. It is no coincidence that we are having this conversation at the confluence of two directly related UN anniversaries: the Fourth World Conference on Women that took place in Beijing 25 years ago, where 183 countries adopted by consensus a platform for action for gender equality, and among its other imperatives laid out the obligations of states to protect women in conflict and recognize that the active participation of women and their incorporation in all levels of decision making was necessary for peace to be achieved. The other multilateral commitment emanated from the UN Security Council 5 years after Beijing, with the adoption of Resolution 1325, linking women's agency to peace and security, recognizing women as key actors, not victims. And over the last 20 years, 9 additional strengthening resolutions were adopted to ensure more effective implementation. There remains, however, a tremendous gulf between the commitment reflected in the framework and its integration in decision-making across the board in all the ways that we have been hearing today. Women still represent only an extremely small percentage of peace negotiators, envoys, mediators, peacekeepers, and so forth, despite the fact that they are directly impacted by conflicts and possess vital knowledge, on-the-ground experience, and other areas important to the outcome of talks and peace building. At the same time, there is a growing evidence-based case documenting the positive difference women's perspectives and participation make to conflict prevention, resolution, recovery. An analysis by UN Women of 40 peace processes since the end of the Cold War shows that where women were able to influence negotiations, there was a much higher chance that agreements would be reached and sustained than when their influence was negligible at best. Women who've been engaged in peace processes from Northern Ireland to Colombia to the Philippines and to places in between put issues on the negotiating table that are critical to creating lasting peace, but frequently overlooked. Issues such as justice, national reconciliation, human rights, economic opportunity, and more. Data shows that they are better at building trust across divided communities, ensuring the needs of marginalized groups that they are represented, forging compromise, acting as honest brokers, and catalyzing public support for agreements once they are reached. Furthermore, the lack of women's participation post-conflict heightens the prospect for relapse into war. Women are critical to stabilizing societies and need to be engaged in the design and implementation of relief efforts. Yet all too often, their participation is not factored into the economic, political, justice, and security sector decision-making. If the moment is seized during the transition from conflict to peace, this critical juncture can set in motion new laws and constitutions to secure rights, ensure accountability, and build the process of democratic institutions. Evidence shows that better outcomes in the public sector occur when women serve in leadership roles at all levels. Services are more efficient, the design of programs is more responsive to community needs, to land rights, to agriculture, jobs, and education. They get priority consideration. And violence against women is often worse post-conflict if plans on the reintegration of combatants are not adequately considered with the provision of economic and psychological support. But as we gather, conflicts continue to flare, and we've heard about that. Peace agreements are abrogated, and there is widespread acknowledgement that conflict prevention and resolution need better approaches. There is a correlation between the failure of peace agreements that are lasting and marginalization of women in peace processes. Women are actively engaged in peace-building efforts in their communities and countries, in track twos and track threes, and in other forms of collective action to resolve conflict. yet their very efforts are seldom, if ever, connected to formal or official peace processes. And this despite the fact that women peace builders have much insight and experience to offer, but they need the support of the stakeholders to often bring them into the process. UN envoys have often embarked on their peace missions without the 1325 mandate being firmed in their peace-building efforts and the imperative that it represents to recognizing the experience of local peace-builders. Effective multilateralism must also recognize and address violence against women as a serious violation of human rights and a threat to peace and security. Conflict-related sexual violence rages still with impunity in many places. And violence against women threatens the security and safety of its victims and represents a broader security concern to society that must not be overlooked as a marginal issue, as it often is. The first Women, Peace, and Security Index that has been published by the Georgetown Institute shows that in nations where the well-being of women is threatened and violence against them is pervasive, those places are most likely to be mired in instability and conflict. We must address those issues as a preventative effort before they are eroded and turn into something far worse. The security of women is one of the most reliable indicators of peaceful societies. Today, there are 86 national action plans on women, peace, and security adopted by member states to advance progress on this issue. In my country, we even have a law on women, peace, and security. But of course, all of this depends on enforcement and implementation. In a few weeks, large numbers of member states will again issue supportive statements during the Security Council's open debate on the anniversary of the adoption of 1325 and proclaim their commitment. However, the disconnect between the powerful words of commitment and their reflection in national policies and actions is often striking. National governments need to connect their national action plans to their diplomatic efforts in conflict-affected areas. There's often a divorce between those separate women, peace, and security actions and the ongoing realities of diplomatic work. This is true in the multilateral level as well. Wherever conflicts flare, women's perspectives and engagements should be integrated into strategies to end those conflicts and build peace. As we've heard, regional organizations also have significant roles to play. Member states participate on several multilateral platforms at the same time. In the OSCE, for example, there are four unresolved conflicts in the region. And despite efforts to make progress on this agenda, and despite leadership support, progress is still halting because achieving consensus is becoming more difficult. One strategy has recently been put forward at the United Nations by a group of member states under the theme of Commitment 2025, to use their collective power, resources, and influence to accelerate progress on the implementation of this agenda in more concrete and targeted ways. We need a reappraisal in the way we are addressing ending conflicts and building sustainable peace. The inclusive approach that was adopted 20 years ago has never been more urgent. Can the multilateral framework for peace deliver, working in collaboration with other actors across sectors, across regions, across all levels in societies? Can the collective action that is necessary be galvanized for the sake of our world and peace? And in today's COVID world, where there has been such a disproportionate impact on women in terms of the consequences to them, this has become even more complicated. The gendered approach to peacebuilding can no longer be just an option. It is a necessity if we are going to do better in preventing conflict, transforming justice, and securing peace. Thank you.
Thank you, Melanne. You reminded us very, very clearly that commitments are not reality, that often we need a greater push to translate commitments into reality. And we also have a perfect circle here, starting with the introduction that President Chinchilla gave us, emphasizing the role of leadership, and in particular, the role of women leaders, and what you are saying about the role of women at large in playing a significant part in our discussion on peace building and conflict management. I will now have to say that both President Chinchilla and Prime Minister Touré had to leave us due to other commitments. So we will be having a conversation among the three panelists, distinguished panelists, I should say, that have that stay with us. And in this regard, I have a few questions that have come from the audience. And I will start with one that caught my eye, because the question is regarding youth and multilateralism, and how are we going to go about making sure that youth embrace this notion of multilateralism where there are so many parts of the world in huge leaders, national leaders, emphasize nationalism, protectionism, an inward look that derays from what we believe is international cooperation. So maybe, Melanne, you were the last one. Maybe I will start from you in this question.
Well, I think while it is true, Susanna, that the role models in terms of political leadership in many places are not the best example for young people in terms of how they will move forward with their lives, I'm frankly quite impressed and hopeful about the way that many are banding together today, really focused on the world that they want to inherit, not one that is mired in conflict, not one that is without economic opportunity, not one that is not different from what they are personally experiencing. And I certainly see in so many efforts that the generation equality, for example, that is holding on to the baton. They don't feel in many ways that it needs to be passed to them, but that they are taking it and running with it to try to make that difference in their communities. And also many of them, because of social media today, working across borders, and influencing each other in positive ways. So I see, while recognizing the enormous numbers of young people, and in some countries, 60 and 70%, and what that represents in terms of our obligations to them and the kind of future they deserve, that many of them in many places are really holding on to a vision for the kind of world they want to see, particularly in their own lives, and are working towards trying to get there in ways small and large.
Thank you, Melanne. Prime Minister Touré said it, that young people are sometimes more principled. And I think that's part of the question. Terje, any comment from your end? Terje, do you hear me?
Sorry. What was the question? You fell out for a while.
Well, if the question is whether we found that
you're so broken, I can hardly hear you.
Maybe you should mute the microphone so we don't
No, it came suddenly. You're so broken, I cannot hear what you're saying. I'm sorry.
Do you hear me now?
Yeah, now it's much better.
Maybe it would be better for you to mute the mic so that I repeat the question. The question was whether young people can be affected by the fact that so many leaders in the world see a more nationalistic approach, a more inward perspective. How are we going to bring them into this notion of the multilateral world that we so much appreciate?
I don't think there are specifics related to youth here. I think this is, demography is into this, but I think education is at the heart of it. Because what we see in basically every country in the world, in Europe, in the US and elsewhere, that is that those who are seduced by the populists, whoever they are mostly people who have very low education and live in rural areas. So education, I think, is at the heart of it. And of course, by implication, education is related to youth. And I think this is of paramount importance in order to stop the destructive forces of populism, which we see everywhere now, paired with racism and Islamophobia, et cetera, in many, many countries.
Thank you, Turgut. Kai, I will bring to you a different question. There is one coming from the audience that asks about the role of media in peace processes, in peace building, in peace talks. Is media a conducive actor? How do you see that role being played?
Conducive, absolutely, both to war. I remember in Colombia one of our partners said, you don't need to have a brigade or a division, all you need is a journalist to fuel and escalate violence. But this links with your prior question. We are on the one hand, ordinary mobilization of youth in so many parts of the world, youth involved in the women's rights movement, LGBTQI plus, youth involved in the global environmental movement. So on the one hand, you are seeing this significant engagement and the wonderful work of youth around the world with the United Network of Young Peacebuilders and around UN 2250 on youth, peace and security. But there's a very different reality happening at the same time. And this is significantly affected by media as in social media, where you are seeing violent extremist ideas, racist and chauvinist ideas actually in many instances increase in youth, not amongst older populations. So if you look at youth in Britain, youth in the United States, youth in China, very often you're seeing an increase in nationalist and chauvinist attitudes. And this is affected in part by the fact that we have had a dramatic increase in concentration of control of media amongst very few media corporations. And you're having, in essence, a democratic dynamic where private media interests are bringing forward their agendas, whether this is through Rupert Murdoch's network or the Breitbart network or many others. From Al-Qaeda and ISIS and Daesh to white supremacist movements around the world, the recognition of the power of social media and promote their message. The challenge is, speakification, for example, misogynist sexist ideas are increasing among white educated men in Britain, in the United States. So when people are being increasingly bombarded with these negative messages, and when we visible the positive movements or positive messages, then that can have a negative dynamic. We need to look at regulation properly of media so that if they show one side, they show another. You can't just, without any control, promote hate messages, as we're seeing that challenging dynamic on social media. And to really begin introduce training in peace journalism, in looking at the positive role media can play in helping to make visible the actual impacts and effects of conflict and violence, but also what's being done for them.
Thank you, Kai. Terje, let me go back to you now and ask you another question regarding the depolarization we see in the world, the heavy geopolitical play that we see these days, that reflected, of course, in the UN Security Council. How do you see in this context the possibility of really getting support from the Security Council to resolutions that take into account the many things that have been said in this panel? How does the Security Council bring them on board?
I didn't catch what was the issue you addressed, which the Security Council is going to address. I didn't quite get the word you pronounced.
Well, given the polarization of the Security Council, how do you see the Security Council embracing resolutions that take into account the many considerations that were brought to bear in this panel, you know, gender, youth, a private sector? There are so many angles that have been put on the table. How do you see that being embraced by a Security Council that cannot agree to sit at the table almost?
As you know, some of the key members of the Security Council, they have a very narrow definition of security, and they want to keep that narrow definition as a framework for what topics can be brought up in the Council. So the chances for the list of issues you just pronounced to become core issues of the Security Council as it is composed now, I hope for very, very, very unlikely. Because, there are, if I may use that word, conservative forces in the Council which wants to keep traditional definitions of security and the mandate of the Security Council and limit it to these issues.
So taking into account what Terje has said, Melanne, what is your view there?
You know, what Turgid said about the narrow view of security and the estimation of some of the permanent members, especially, I had a conversation with a representative of one on this Women, Peace and Security agenda, because I could not understand why in a regional setting, when this issue came up, there was not support from that member state that historically didn't vote against the Women, Peace and Security agenda. But when the rubber hit the road, so to speak, it was a completely different response. It was, well, that doesn't apply to this security situation. So we've got this view of being part of the solution as it suits a narrow definition of security, as opposed to the way it needs to be factored in as was originally intended. This polarization, I think, is a real problem, and I don't know what the solution is. Political leadership change, certainly, but when that comes and how that gets manifested obviously remains to be seen. But just the specter in the debate on COVID, which by any account is a security problem for the world, where there couldn't be agreement no matter how serious the efforts were, and in this case, the United States and China really not budging in their positions, really did not result in the kind of robust call to for international action and commitment that was necessary.
Can we hear each other, panelists, or?
So, getting to this point, we are hitting the end of our conversation. I was saying, we see here a situation, as you rightly pointed out, of a confrontation between a broad range of interventions that can be seen as positive, as moving forward the agenda we have before us, with the backdrop of a Security Council that is at a deadlock. My sense is that it is our duty to think on the positive side and to work on all those areas that can reinvigorate the interventions in peacebuilding, peacekeeping, peacemaking, in conflict resolution, while we wait, as Melanne indicated, that maybe there is a hope that some change in the dynamics comes out of changes in leadership. Still, there is a lot to do, and I think it is our duty to keep moving forward and to work towards that. So I thank you. I thank the Club of Madrid, the World Alliance, and I really thank you all for providing us with this rich exchange that gives us a lot of food for thought. Thanks to you all, and I now pass the floor to our host. Thank you very much.
Very much. Thank you.
For steering such a distinguished and thought-provoking panel on transforming the multilateral framework for peace. A word of deep appreciation again to Ms. Verveer, Executive Director of the Georgetown Institute for Women, Peace and Security, to Mr. Kai Bran Jakobsen, President of the Romanian Peace Institute, Mr. Rod Larsen, President of the International Peace Institute, Ms. Laura Chinchilla, former President of Costa Rica, and Ms. Aminata Torre. Thank you, Chair, for guiding us, Madam Malcorra, Dean of IE School of Global Affairs. We're grateful to you for these insights. That ends our final plenary for today. And before adjourning and allowing you to continue through virtual networking meetings, we will begin tomorrow promptly at 10 a.m. Central European time and focus on action labs related to women, peace, and security, then tackling the role of the private sector in advancing peace and partnership, and also on the role of regional organizations as collective mechanisms to address peace and security. A word of appreciation again to all of the distinguished panelists, and I hereby adjourn this policy lab for today and welcome you to continue over a virtual networking meeting. Thank you.